Giuliana Zanotto. I'm a PhD candidate here in planning policy and design at the School of Social Ecology in UCI. And for this past 3 years, I've been involved in an initiative called Empowering Sustainability. It is my honor to be here today to talk about this initiative and to introduce the work of some of our female fellows who are an integral part of this work. Over the last 48 years, this campus has become a special place, a place where the future is discussed and shaped every day by people who have a vision. They believe that we can do better. We at UCI understand that to do better, we need an integrative and holistic approach, because the problems we face today are not only very serious, but also extremely complex. We need the passion of all the academics in this campus. We need the energy of our students. We need the work of our governments. We need the participation of civil society. And we need the involvement of the private sector. We need to get together to do better, to build the future that we want, a future where all people live in peace, where we all enjoy equal rights and responsibilities, where we look out for each other and for the other creatures with whom we share the earth, and where the future generations are not deprived of essential resources. This future is more than a desire. It has increasingly become a matter of survival. The Empowering Initiative at UCI supports young leaders who have the potential of, or are already, shaping a better world. They form a diverse group of academics, practitioners, and activists from 28 countries. Our goals with this initiative are, one, to connect stakeholders who strive to discover and embody sustainability through practice, and who share a common goal of shaping a sustainable future. And two, to support and foster engagement and research on the ground. The networking and exchange of ideas and experiences among members of this group and like-minded organizations locally is part of the integrative approach needed in order to understand and address extremely challenging environmental and social issues. The five women who are going to speak today are part of the Empowering Sustainability Initiative. They are professors, activists, and professionals of the public, nonprofit, and private sectors. They understood that we need to start somewhere, that each one of us has a positive contribution to make. They are working on their communities to make a difference, to do better. I said earlier that making the world better, just, and sustainable is an imperative for planetary survival. It is so because, as we know, we're overusing resources we depend on, and we're damaging the ecosystems that we are a part of. But there is something else that makes building a better future a matter of survival. And this is something particularly important to women, yet it is rarely discussed. We women have increasingly acquired the right to make decisions about our own bodies. This is unquestionably a fundamental right that we want every woman in every country to have, and we will fight for that. But with this right comes the responsibility of deciding whether or not we want to bring our children into this world. Only very recently I realized that the ugliness of the realities that we face every day may discourage women to have children, to perpetuate our species. I was in Istanbul, Turkey last week, and a friend of mine took me to Taksim Square. Taksim Square was the center of protests a month ago. Protesters who were fighting to preserve the square as a green public space were violently attacked by the police. My friend, who attends graduate school nearby, explained that her school had become an impromptu clinic to care for those who were wounded during the protests. She concluded her account of the daily violence she witnessed with a sad remark. She said she will not have children. This world, she said, is filled with violence, suffering, and injustice, and she would not want her children to witness all that. I agree with her. I do not want my children to live in this world, in the world that she described. But the work of people like these women who are going to talk to you, and the work of people like many of you here, have inspired me. And it makes me believe that we can do better. I want all of you to believe we can do better. And this is why UCI is working on a new program for empowering women. This program is led by Vice Chancellor Thomas Parham with the collaboration of visionary community members, including Kathy, who is here, Lori and Chase Warmington, Marjorie and Heather, Professor Whiteley and Norma. The goal of this program is to empower women by connecting local women's groups with international women like the Sustainable Fellows to support and learn more about the shared values and experiences that are unique to women. So we have asked these women to tell us how they are making a difference. I'll ask them to come here, introduce themselves and their work to you. Thank you.
My name's Allison Cook, and I work at the Story of Stuff Project. And the first thing that I wanted to just say is thank you. There's something so lovely and energizing and restoring about being in a room full of women sharing a meal who you know are totally badass. And I was telling Professor Whiteley this morning that's actually part of why I like coming to the Empowering Sustainability Fellowship is because I re-engage with my work after spending time down here more excited, more renewed, more ready to decide that, yes, I do want to have a family because there is this incredible community of people who are making change all over the world. So to tell you a little bit about my work personally, I work at an organization called the Story of Stuff Project. We make short animated cartoons about where your stuff comes from, how it's made, and the social and environmental impacts along the way. So it turns out that our relationship with stuff is pretty messed up, in case you haven't seen the movie. And so overall, we're using too much stuff, we're using too toxic stuff, and we're not sharing it very well. There are a lot of people who are overwhelmed by the amount of stuff that they have, and then there are people who simply do not have enough. And so we made this original movie about 6 years ago now, and it has been incredibly successful in a way that we never anticipated. It has been seen by over 38 million people and has been translated into over 30 languages across the globe. And we have then expanded that format to try and talk about different issues. So we've taken on bottled water or electronics and to try and connect the dots between the workers who make these products, the environments where the resources are extracted, and the way we interface with them in our day-to-day lives. And what has been really interesting in this work is that it's become really clear to us that people understand that there's a problem, they want to do something about it, but they don't know where to start. And I think that one of the things that's particularly compelling about that is it means that we've done our jobs in a lot of ways. So I think we can pat ourselves on the back in that a lot of people understand that there are incredible social, environmental, and political problems that we face. But now the question is, what do we do about it? And so at the Story of Stuff, we kind of talk about it as kind of you have two muscles, if you will. So you have your citizen muscle and your consumer muscle. And our consumer muscles, especially in the United States, have been stroked and nurtured and validated from the moment that we exit the womb so that we are very good at making educated consumer choices about how to get the best deal, how to get the most bang for our buck, how to get almost anything we need delivered to our doorstep within 24 hours. But then when it comes to the larger social problems that we face, whether it's our environment, whether we're caring about women's rights, whether we care about getting a stop sign in an intersection that is unsafe, we don't necessarily know how to engage in that way. We don't know how to engage as citizens, as people who care about our communities. I think that most of the women in this room are an exception to that rule, but that it is a skill set that we need to cultivate and nurture because we cannot solve problems like the AIDS epidemic or the need for education or the need for technology with making educated consumer choices. We need to strengthen that citizen muscle. And so right now, one of the projects that we're working on is we're going to continue the media work that we're known for, but we're actually working on a 6-week citizen muscle boot camp to get people engaged in the skills and tools and resources that they need to make change in their communities on the issues that they care about. And right now, we're just testing it out so that we can make it live in the fall. But if any of you are interested in talking more about any of this work, it is why I love what I do. And I'm excited to be in a room of other people who feel the same way.
Do you want to show the clip?
Oh, do you guys want to see a clip of our? I just talked for a long time. Okay, so this is actually the clip for our movie, The Story of Change. So people were coming to us and saying, I want to make change, I don't know where to start. And so this is a little bit, this is my colleague, Annie Leonard.
I've come to see that we all have two different parts of ourselves, a consumer part and a citizen part. It's almost like two different muscles. The consumer muscle is spoken to and fed and validated so much that it's become our primary identity, while our citizen muscle is atrophying. And this is a problem because when we're faced with gigantic challenges like disruption of the global climate or babies being born pre-polluted with 250 industrial chemicals already in their blood, the best that we can think of doing is carrying a reusable grocery bag to the store? So how do we make big change?
As you can see, I'm the president and co-founder of Saimiri Foundation. Saimiri is the Latin name for the squirrel monkey. And when I was asked to talk about what was the difference I'm doing, I just thought, like, in Costa Rica, we are so many women doing, like, a big change. So I wanted to also let you know a little bit about the role of women as leaders in the Osa Peninsula. This is the logo of my foundation, and as you can see, I do research, I follow the monkeys in the wild, I also give other presentations in local communities. Sometimes I also like to work in the field, really in the field, and as you can see in this picture, behind me there's a woman that can milk a cow in 5 minutes with his two hands, so sometimes I want to try to do the same. I also do some habitat restoration with some plants, some trees that people can use after they grow for timber wood instead of taking the wood from the forest. This is the squirrel monkeys that I love. And this is one of the quotes that really inspires me. The least I can do is to speak out for those who cannot speak for themselves. And sometimes this is just not about monkeys that they cannot speak for themselves. Sometimes local communities, rural communities don't have the tools to talk for themselves. So we also do a lot of work with them. And I also want to show in this presentation women that inspires me to keep going in my work. This is Carol. She came from the US. And she has a wildlife sanctuary, and she's holding Guapo. Guapo is a spider monkey that passed away last year, but he was chained and was like hit. He had broken ribs, and she recovered him. And this is a hug he gave him, not like spontaneously after not seeing her 3 days. And so the work women do with animals is amazing. And what keeps her also going is to think there's still 5% of monkeys in nature that gets caught for being a pet or for being just hunt them for sometimes still life for eating their meat. There's another biologist that inspires me in the Osa Peninsula, and Gloriana Chaveri. She inspires me a lot because she has a PhD and a postdoctoral, and it's some of the talents we have in the Osa Peninsula. She studied bats, which, by the way, I love to. Pilar, she came from Colombia, and she works with another organization, and we work together sometimes in local communities, and she also was inspired, as well as myself,
and
with the work of Jacques Cousteau.
That.
I think Jacques Cousteau was a huge impact in my generation. He made us dream that you could travel the world looking for species that you don't know. An activist, and I think there's a lot of women in Costa Rica fighting for the same environment that we want, something that where women are equally treated, where women have their human basic rights. Bueno, some of the lessons I learned in life is that women, we are so powerful. We are the ones that raise our kids, that we need to dream big to act now. I was still talking previously with Lori about acting now, and I think acting now is all the time. You have to act now, today, tomorrow. Is something that I've learned, and to help others and to be honest. I really think when you work with your heart, it doesn't really matter what you do, but if you're doing it with your heart, you will have good results. So just make things happen. That's what I do.
I'm a professor of environmental law and sustainable development in São Paulo, Brazil, at Mackenzie University. As you see the little M over there. I'm also vice coordinator nowadays of the master and PhD program on politics and economic law, where I develop a sort of some research on the field of environmental law and environmental international law. One of them, I had a grant from the National Agency of Research, CNPq. I have a little French accent because I have been living for 8 years in France, and so maybe it's that you said that I have a beautiful accent. And thank you. And okay, and sorry if I choose also the French words. And this project is about law and sustainable development, water and forest law on Amazon region, considering climate change. As I have been working also in Amazon region for 10 years at the State University of Amazonas, I became also an environmental law consultant, and nowadays I'm coordinating a great project financed by Global Environmental Fund and United Nations Environmental Program and Amazon Cooperation Treaty Organization in the legal harmonization of law in this region, water legislation in this region, considering climate change. I have some fields of interest that are water law, forest law, social and biodiversity law, wastes, environmental law. And if you want, we can discuss after. But I'm not only an environmental law professor. I do not only look the law on the books, but I'm also thinking the law in the practice. And so I'm part on the government. I'm part of the National Commission of Biosafety, of Technical National Technical Commission of Biosecurity, or Biosafety, as representative of consumers' rights. It means we deal with genetic modified crops, if we consider that we can put this in our table or not. I'm part of the minority part in this commission that are very worried about the precautionary principle. I'm also part of a group of study in the Ministry of Agrarian Development that are, we are 19 persons, and we are giving advice to the ministry in the field of agrobiodiversity. But I not only do that, I'm also part of many NGOs, non-governmental organizations. I put only three of them over there that are, first of all, Lawyers for a Green Planet, one of the most important NGOs in Brazil. Our task is to defend and protect environment, biodiversity, and indigenous rights. We would like to improve, and we try to improve, equilibrium between development and environmental protection through great awareness and citizen participation, improving capacity building of judges, lawyers, and prosecutors. We are worried about also proper implementation and improvement of environmental legislation, effective access to justice, and improving the quality of life. The two other NGOs that I'm a part of is the IUCN Academy of Environmental Law, where I am part of research committee, and the Brazilian Association of Environmental Professors, where I am academic coordinator. We try to build sustainability capacity and legal education and advance conceptual understanding and implementation of environmental law. To end this little speech quickly, I would like to tell you that sometimes we are thinking about what's important, what can make the difference? And we are discussing about what can make the difference. What we need? Maybe as a lawyer, I can say, all we need is law. Yes, they said to us, maybe no. All we need is not law, but we need order. An order that takes into account ecological balance. And so maybe we can say that all we need is law, but in the sense that women see the world, all we need is love. Let's try to love each other. Thanks.
My name is Lucia, and I come from the north of Spain. I want to tell you a little bit what I do. Well, I'm a chemical engineer, graduated in the University of Cantabria, and I also have a master's degree in environmental engineering. And what do I do? Well, I've been working in a Spanish government environmental company called MARE. And there I was working as a waste and energy management technician, where I was in charge of the two main landfills in my community, in my region. And also I was in charge of the management of the clean points, helping people to recycle and constructing facilities so it's easier to recycle for everybody. I want to show you some pictures of my works. This is one of the landfills in my region. And also during last year and this year, this is another landfill that is being sealed. And as you can see, we are trying to integrate the landfill with the mountains, with the landscape that we have in this zone. And well, since February this year, I decided to change to another company. This time it's a private company called Textil Santanderina. It's a Spanish fabrics manufacturing company with a wide presence all around the world. There, I'm working as an agent, security, quality, and environmental management technician, where I develop duties related to quality, like all the certifications, the ISO certifications, and also the integrated management systems, but also environmental issues such as waste management, water treatment, and environmental certifications. I wanted to show you, we have a wastewater treatment plant since 1988. In Spain, in the 1980s, there were places where there weren't even water treatment plants for water the companies. And this company already had their own wastewater treatment plant. So in that picture, you can see how water with all the dyeing products arrives to our wastewater treatment plant and how we put the water back into the rivers. And we also have, and I will be participating in a research project with the University of Cantabria. We have a pilot plant since last year, and we are trying to find their better techniques to treat the water. So I hope we get some improvements to find better ways to treat water. And well, to end with my presentation, I would like to say why I do what I do. Well, I could start speaking and say a lot of things that why I want to do what I'm doing. But there's a sentence that summarizes very well what I feel, and is that the world is not an inheritance from our parents. We borrow it from our children. So I think there's a lot to be done, and I want to contribute making this possible. Thank you.
My name is Rocio Carranza. I'm a 33 years old Costa Rican woman. I'm an actress since I had 11 years old. And I'm an activist in social, political, and environmental things. I'm sorry because of my English. Who I am is determined because of where I come from. Those are my parents. They're from Argentina. They escaped to Costa Rica after being persecuted for a year and my dad kidnapped and almost being for several months, tortured because of trying to solve the crimes made by militars during the dictatorship. There was where he was kidnapped and tortured. So we went with them. and they went to Costa Rica. Costa Rica is a country without army, one of the five countries with more biodiversity in the world. So it's almost inevitable for me not to get involved in social stuff and political stuff. And the art is an instrument for communication, sensibilization, and hopefully change. Because I acted since little, I was usually called to support many causes. But then one day I began to say, well, I don't have to expect to be called. I will begin mobilizing myself, empowering myself. So I began making chains with people and searching for organizations that were interested in my same interests. For this, the social net has been very helpful. I at least have like 14,000 people, friends, for example. So they all listen my messages. And so for me, it's like an obligation to do what I do. People always tell me, but why are you doing that? If you're an actress, you don't even gain money in activism. Well, it's an obligation for me. My interests are, I'm sorry because of my English, some things I have to read. Interest in working on processes that call into question and help shape and improve the country's development model on the basis of democracy, social equity, justice, ecosystem and natural resources protection, and sustainable development. I work, in the street. I do manifestations, concerts, organize them, but also I go to communities, excluded communities, or sometimes I need to be in an office with a minister, or so I have a very various work, variety of places to work, and I really like that. We need to accept our differences with men because that differences are what makes us women unique. People ask me, why do you do that? I do that because we need more women in public spaces, political spaces, social spaces. In my experience, it called my attention the input of women in the different causes. Women offer a different perspective to embrace and solve the problems. By nature, we are creative, we are sensitive, we are inclusive. So we need, for the sake, our sake, and for the sake of the world, we need more women outside there. And we can't expect only for a law to change that or for a man to see us as equal. It's our job. We can't expect that. Yes, they have to do that, and the law should be done. But if we don't unite as women, we all, in the different things we do, because I'm a simple example that no matter that I have no money, I'm an actress, I'm a woman, I'm young, and I can do a lot of things that can change the way of my country or the life of the people. So no matter who we are, each one of us has something unique that the world needs. So we should make a circle as women. Thank you, not for listening to me, but for giving me the space to know you. And I hope we know better. Thank you.
I just wanted to, I hope you're all inspired. I think that the passion of these women for doing good is inspiring. And UCI actually wants to support that kind of work. We want to connect this type of women that are doing work out there with local women's group here in Orange County.